Hello, good evening. Welcome to the 7th program of Hammurabi I Hand and Student. I Hand and Student is basically a forum in which law students get a platform where they can share their views and they can share their research on the topics which they like to give. Hammurabi's 7th program is very much one step ahead for law students, where they get to know and get to explore what the law field, what the law stream is all about, and exploring their subjects and going into the deep what the subject is about to tell to each and everyone. Basically, today we have been inviting Rudra Dani from KES Law College, who will be giving the overview of the Indian Penal Code 1860, whereas in which Rudra is about to share his views, his research about what the Indian Penal Code is about. We have been knowing about what is Indian Penal Code, where we got to know what are the penalties, what are the sections, what are the different sections in which crimes have been committed, recent amendments in the year 2013, criminal law amendments which have been framed by the parliament and by the constitution in the recent times. All these things should be covered by the next person named Rudra Dani. So not taking more time, I would like to invite Rudra and sharing his view and about the topic of Indian Penal Code. Rudra.
Good evening to one of the presenters. My name is Rudra Dani, and today I will. My topic for today's discussion is the Indian Penal Code and its overview. Before I open up a session with Indian Penal Code, I would like to state what is the crime and its historical background of a crime. So the crime, in its ordinary sense, means you can say a wrong or a public wrong or any act which is committed with malafide intention against either individual or against a society. In history, if I speaking about the background, the historical background of a crime, then there were many laws, there were many regulations which are passed in order to administer justice and in order to control this crime, control this of various crime and offences. However, I get one act, one law which left certain impact on the crime, that is a Mohammedan criminal law. Now, this Mohammedan criminal law is based on 5 elements: Kisa, Diya, Had, Tazir, Siyasat. So, the term Kisa means it turns in retribution, like an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. Then afterwards, Diya. Diya means blood money, where if your act cause any harm to another person, then you are bound to pay the compensation. It is all about the Diya. Then Had, where a judge is bound to pass any sentence. However, it must fall within the law. He cannot use the discretionary power. Whereas the Tazir is totally opposite to what Had. What is mentioned in the Had, which means the judge has discretionary power to pass a sentence. Even for example, for any small offense, even he can pass any sentence. And the last one is the Siyasat, which means the king, in order to protect the interest of the society, may pass any sentence. Okay. Now, afterwards, I would like to move on to the theories of punishment. So generally, there are 5 theories of punishment. The first one is a retributive theory, where an eye for it means an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, life for life, limb for limb. Okay, after retributive theory, the next theory is the deterrent theory. The main crux of the deterrent theory is to give the hardest punishment to the offender, so that in order to set an example for the other people, so that even other people think that no, if we commit this crime, then even we will get the same punishment. Now, the next theory is the reformative theory. This theory is supported by Mahatma Gandhiji. The main crux of the theory is, rather than killing a patient, it is better to cure his disease. If I explain this theory in terms of crime, then rather than giving the hardest punishment to criminal, it is better to change his mindset, so that even when he start working for himself, then he realize how wrong he was. Okay, then afterwards, the next theory is the expedient theory, or you can say the big-hearted theory, where if, for example, if any person, Mr. A, commit a crime against B, then B, by big heart, he need to, you know, just forgive him, just let go of what Mr. A done with him. Okay, and afterwards, the last theory is a preventive theory. Preventive theory is if the court feel, if the judge feel that so-and-so person is about to commit a crime, then the judge may either pass any order so that in order to prevent that person from committing a crime, either they forfeit the property or either they impose a fine or take any necessary step. Now, afterwards, I would like to move on to the kinds of punishment in the ancient time. Okay, so there are some of the punishment. The first one is a branding, like you can say the Mera Bab Chore kind of punishment. Then afterwards, transportation, where you are not supposed to, where you are not allowed to cross the territory of particular city or particular village. Then afterwards, amputation. For example, if you commit theft, then your right hand is cut off. And similar kind of offense is there in such in ancient India. Now, I would like to proceed with the Indian Penal Code. When I speak the word crime, then on some time I feel that it is synonymous to the intention. Because when, if there is an intention, then there is a crime. On this point, I would like to give an example. For example, if you know doctor while operating, open up your stomach, then you cannot prosecute a doctor for any offense, for like for grievous hurt or anything, because doctor has no intention to kill you. He open up your stomach just in order to operate you and in order to save your life, in order to improve your health condition. Because if he want to kill you, then he has many ways to kill you. Why it takes so much trouble to open up your stomach and all? Okay, so and even Latin, even there was one Latin maxim which also support this, that an act is not a crime unless it has certain intention of doing so. Then as far as the Indian Penal Code is concerned, then it is categorized into 23 chapters. Now I would like to move on to the first chapter, that is a general explanation. So general explanation is where the terms or words which are frequently used in an act are defined. For example, the calendar. The calendar means year. So year means where a particular year starts, begins from the 1st April and so and so. As far as the intention is concerned, then on very less point you find the word where in many in offense where they expressly mention about the intention, because there are other words which shows that there is an intention, like dishonestly, then maliciously, fraudulently, which is defined under section 24 and 25 of the Indian Penal Code. Then after, as far as the crime is concerned, then there are four stages of crime: the intention, preparation, attempt and commission. The main thing is first you have the intention. If you have intention, then it goes ahead. For example, if there are four persons who have intention to causing and hurt to another person, so first they have intention that if they have any certain kind of person grudge against that person, then they have intention, then they prepare accordingly, then they collect some of the weapon, then attempt that if they call so and so person to so and so place, and commission by either by shooting or either by any kind of the act, and they fulfill their purpose. So these are the four stages of the crime. Now, I would like to move on to the chapter 2, that is a punishment, which runs in a section 53 to section 75. So, the first punishment, and I think it's one of the most gravest punishment, is the death penalty. The death, as far as our Indian Penal Code is concerned, then there are only 9 offenses where if you commit that offense, then you will sure that you will get a death penalty. So, some of the examples are the murder, then dacoity accompanied with murder, then abetting of the mutiny, then waging war against the state. As far as the recent statistics is concerned, then last, it is in 2017 to 2018, more than 100 death penalty were awarded, but none of the death penalty were executed in India. And as far as the table topping is concerned, then as usual, China topped the table. However, they don't reveal their statistics about the death penalty, but China topped the table, as China awarded as well as executed the highest number of death penalty in that particular year. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the life imprisonment. Life imprisonment, there were many debates on life imprisonment. Some say that the term of 14 years is a life imprisonment. Some say that the period of 20 years is a life imprisonment. However, section 376, the punishment for rape, it clearly mentioned that life imprisonment means natural reminder of the offender's life. Okay. And as far as our Indian Penal Code is concerned, there are 55 offences which cover under the life imprisonment. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the solitary confinement. The solitary confinement means where you are, the particular offender, the prisoner, is confined within a room. And there is the only like hall where they get certain, you know, sunlight. There is the only way where they just get a sunlight. And I think it is very grave in mental perception. And even Supreme Court issued many guidelines that how you, that as far as the application of solitary confinement is concerned. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the rigorous imprisonment, the Kalapani, where generally it is also awarded in the rape cases, where rigorous imprisonment for 20 years, for 7 years, as the case may be. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the fine, where generally if we violate the traffic rules, then generally we pay a particular fine, the 100 rupees. If we fail to wear the helmet, then we pay the 100 rupees and we go, and accordingly. I think the last punishment is the forfeiture of property. If court fails to forfeit the property, then court may pass the order. It may be the case that court intend to it may be the case that either court want to prevent that person from committing a crime or any other purpose for which the court award the forfeiture of property. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the third chapter, that is a general exception, which runs under section 76 to section 95. There are general, each and every act has certain general exceptions, and so does the IPC has certain general exceptions. The first general exception is the Judicial Act. While during the trial, if any kind of error, any mistake is committed, then the particular judicial officer may take a plea that he, since he is performing the Judicial Act, so he is immune from the punishment. Then the next exception is the mistake, where you order a pizza from the Domino's and you told that guy deliver in 401 and he delivered in 402. So accordingly, he can take a plea of mistake. But mistake of fact, not mistake of law. Because as far as mistake of law is concerned, there are also Latin maxim that ignorance of fact is allowed, but ignorance of law is not allowed. Then afterwards, the next exception is an act in order to avoid the accident. For example, if you are driving a car and suddenly you saw something, or suddenly in order to avoid the accident, either for example the truck is there, suddenly you saw the truck and you just immediately, in order to avoid the, your accident with the truck, you immediately stop the car. So the person sitting behind you cannot prosecute it, no, your act caused me injury. You are supposed to take a plea that no, you are immediately stop the car just in order to avoid the accident, and you have no other intention to harm that particular person. Then afterwards, intoxication, where if any person committed any crime but under the influence, either liquor or under the influence of some medicine, and even he is not aware about the act which he is performing or the nature of act that which is resulting into the offense, then he can take a plea of intoxication. Then the next one is the child. As far as the child is concerned, then the child below the age of 7 years is immune from the punishment, but child above the age of 7 years but below the age of 12 years, then in such case the judge may pass any order, but after knowing the understanding of a child on the nature of act that he committed, then the judge can pass any order. Either he may immune him punishment, the chance of punishment is very less, but it depends upon the judge. Okay, then afterwards I would like to move on to the insanity. I think there was one of the classic case on insanity, the McNaughton versus McNaughton case, where the particular person who killed another person just because he was under the pretense that he killing the Prime Minister of England or some Secretary of England. And afterwards he took a plea of this case, that he was insane. And accordingly the court set him free. Then afterwards, then nextly, I would like to move on to the voluntary non-fit injury, that is section 87 to section 91, where if particular person concerned the harm, then afterwards he cannot prosecute you. Then afterwards I would like to move on to the private defense. This is section 96 to 106. Each and every person has a right to defend his property, himself as well as his family. However, there is a one important condition is, for example, if Mr. A commit any act which resulted into the amputation of any finger of Mr. B, then Mr. B is emperor, mischief, he is liable to inflict the same pain through Mr. A, but it must be in the same proportion. If act of Mr. A resulted into the cutting finger of Mr. B, then Mr. B cannot kill Mr. A. Mr. B is also liable to give some pain, but it must be in the same proportion. It should not be increased. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the abetment, section 107, where abetment is where any person instigate, any person aid something so that you commit a particular offense. I think that's the abetment. Here on this point, I remember, but I got one case where the husband told the wife that if you jump from that particular building by pronouncing the Ram Ram Ram, you will get a heaven. And the wife jumped from that building. So the court found the husband guilty for abetment of committing a suicide. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the offense against the election. That is section 171, where it defines the who is a candidate, then it defined what is a bribery, then it also states that the undue influence during the election, then afterward the cheating by personation, is section 171D. For example, if on my card if you vote, then it's a cheating by personation. Then afterwards it prescribes certain amount of punishment for this act. And the last one is all the party must give particular account. They must produce the account, they must maintain the books of record for the election. Afterwards, I would like to move on to the section 299. That is, I think it's one of the biggest chapters in the Penal Code. That is the offense against human body. So section 299 deal with the culpable homicide. Culpable homicide means cutting the body with intention. And the next thing is murder. Section 300 deal with the murder, where if your act cause any kind of injury, or if you give a blow to another person in such a way that your act amount to death of such person, then it is a murder. However, there are certain exceptions of the murder. Like, there are five exceptions mainly. The first is a grave and sudden provocation, where in Neeraj Grover case, I would like to cite here, where the Mr. Oram, just he received the call, and when he heard the voice of Mr. Neeraj behind the Susai Mariaj, then he suddenly, immediately he left his basement, his Navy basement, immediately he came here and killed Mr. Neeraj Grover. So it shows that how he got the grave and sullen provocation, that in the grave and sullen provocation, he immediately killed Mr. Neeraj Grover. So the condition is the provocation must be grave and sudden, both must be at the same moment. Otherwise, it will not apply. Then the next is sudden fight. For example, if two groups visited any particular bar cum restaurant, and after some verbal exchange, if suddenly the fight start between the two groups and one of the members kill the member of another group, then it fall under this exception, since there is no intention to kill him, but it was happened so suddenly and suddenly take place. Then next one is the consent. For example, if any person is suffering from any disease, you can say a cancer, and you even you can't see him in pain. Anyone is here that please give me the poison. Now it's unbearable for me. This pain is unbearable, and his life is pathetic. And on his word, if you give him a poison, so this is it's fall under the concern. Then the next exception is the next exception is where the public servant exceeds his authority. But how, as far as this public servant case is concerned, then it is necessary that public servant must show this thing, that whatever he is doing, whatever is at intent, it's at last intent to protect the interest of the people and not for any personal ill will. And the last defense in this case is the private defense, which I already explained. Then the next, after murder, I would like to deal with attempt to murder. That is 307. As far as the attempt is concerned, then attempt is half of the commission. One commission equal to two attempt, or you can say the attempt is half of commission, where the punishment for murder is death penalty, So the punishment for attempt to murder is life imprisonment. Okay. Then section 309. Section 309 is attempt to commit suicide. It was the only offense in the IPC which was punished only for the attempt but not for the commission. Because if you commit suicide, then definitely God will punish you. But even by the recent amendment, even it was repealed, 309. And even since even the court was so overburdened with the cases of suicide, so even they get some relaxation from these cases. Now afterwards, I would like to move on to the section 3110. That is the thug. Who is a thug? Generally, the person who are in the group, but in who always accompany the group where in the case and who commit the crime of dacoity, who commit the crime of murder. And section 311 describes the punishment for the thug. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the hut. Section 319, the simple hut. Now here I would like to take the hut and grievous hut simultaneously. The classic example for hurt, if you slap someone, then it's a hurt. But if you slap someone in such a way that it resulted into dislocation of any tooth, then it's a grievous hurt. The punishment for hurt is only 2 years, but the punishment for grievous hurt is more than 7 years. As far as the definition of grievous hurt is concerned, then it includes the permanent musculation, or the person who suffers the pain for 21 days so that even he was unable to perform his normal, his regular function, any kind of functions, then it fall under the grievous hurt. Then after grievous hurt, I would like to move on to the wrongful restraint. For example, if Chirag said me, Rudra, I want to go for a moot court, let me go. And I prevent his way. He has a right to go in the direction, but I stopped that no. Please wait, either by excuse or either by force, I will not let him go for the moot court, and for which he missed the date. So it's a wrongful restraint. Since even I have some intention behind it, that Chirag would not participate in the moot court. So that's why it's falling in the wrongful restraint. And the wrongful confinement is where I confine any person beyond this four wall. Then it falls in the wrongful confinement. Even the wrongful confinement is classified accordingly, like wrongful confinement for 2 days, for 10 days, and even punishment is also vary accordingly. Even as far as the cases of wrongful confinement is concerned, then even Article 32 is also applied. It is our habeas corpus. Even though it is a public, even though it is detention by the police in the police officer, or even it falls under the private custody. Then afterwards, I would like to move on. I would like to move on to the kidnapping directly. Section 359. If you split the word, the kid and napping, so sometimes you feel the sleeping child. But this offense is started by kidnapping the child. That's why it got a name of the kidnapping. Even kidnapping is classified into two: the kidnapping from India and kidnapping from your lawful guardian. As far as the kidnapping from India, if I kidnap any person, then it's kidnapping from India. But kidnapping from lawful guardian is where I kidnap any particular boy or girl who has not attained his majority, or the person who is of unsound mind. And if I take out that person without the permission of the guardian, then it falls under the kidnapping from lawful authority or guardian in 360. The punishment for the kidnapping is 7 years. Now next, I would like to move on to the abduction. Abduction is not an offense, but abduction means where I force any person to go that particular place. And afterwards, that if any offense is committed, then this abduction and that offense will club, and the accused will get a offender will get the punishment accordingly. Now the next thing is, for the first time in the Indian Penal Code, they explain what is the who is a beggar. Under section 363A, even it was added, it deals with the kidnapping of the person, child, for the purpose of begging. So it gives a small definition, who is a beggar. The beggar is a person who is receiving or soliciting in the alms under the pretense of dance, song, or under the pretense of showing the injury and all. Then afterwards, I would like to move on to the afterwards I would like to move on to the 378, that is theft. The theft means, for example, if I take out this, if I take away this mobile phone from your custody, from your possession, without your permission, then it is a theft. As far as the extortion is concerned, under Section 383, if I threaten you, you give me the mobile phone, then by threatening you, I taking your phone from your possession, then it's the extortion, for which the punishment is 7 years. As far as theft is concerned, the punishment also 7 years. As far as the robbery is concerned, the robbery, either in robbery the theft is included, or either they must be extortion, either they must be the theft. Now, the next offense is one of the most heinous offense in the world, dacoity, where Section 392 of the Indian Penal Code deal with dacoity, where five or more person adjointly committed a crime, adjointly committed the robbery, either with intent to robbing the bank and all, then it fall under the dacoity. The classic example is where there are five person for Mr. ABCDE who had intent to rob the bank. So first they have the blueprint, then after five, Mr. A is waiting outside and keep an eye on the each and every movement which take place outside the bank. Mr. B who destroy the CCTV camera, Mr. C who breaking the locker, Mr. D who further breaking the locker of the safe custody, and Mr. E who just collecting a cash. So here all the five are liable to commit dacoity. However, if during this act, if suddenly the security guard come, what are you doing here? And if any one of them commit a murder, then it is dacoity accompanied with murder, which is again most heinous offense, and which is fall under one of the offenses which is punishable with death penalty. It is so grave in nature. Then after dacoity, I would like to move on to the cheating. That is section 415 to 420. The cheating is where I deliver any kind of statement believing it to be false, then it's the cheating. For example, if I say to Chirag that Chirag, you invest in my company and you will get double in within a 1 year. I know that this statement is false, but he believes that no, I think it's a good opportunity to earn some money, and he invest in my company. And afterwards, if he come to know that no, it's a shell company or it's a fraud, then I'm liable for the, I'm fall under this offense, this cheating. There was one landmark case, one English case, Derry versus Pick. In this case, the director of the company, through his prospectus, stated that we are planning to run so-and-so train, and definitely we will get a permission from the government. But the government refused to give the permission in such case, and the shareholder who on the basis of prospectus purchased the share who sue the director on the ground that you commit fraud on us. But the court held that since the director actually believing the statement to be true and he has no intention to defraud the shareholder, then the director is not liable for the cheating. Now after the cheating, I would like to move on to the criminal trespass. There is section 441. We already learned the concept of trespass under the tort. It runs in some similar line, but with some variation. That is where any person enter into the property of another without his permission, that is a criminal trespass. Then the next one is house trespass. When any person enter into your house without your permission, then it's a house trespass. Then the next one is lurking house trespass, where any person enter into your house in such a way by that, you know, he takes some precaution in order to conceal his identity that he enter into your house, then it's a lurking house trespass. Now the next one is lurking house trespass by night. Since the offense is committed after the sunrise, after sunset, then the offense becomes little grave. The lurking house trespass by night, any person enter into a house at night by concealing his identity. And the last one is house breaking, where any person either open the lock of your door, or either break down the window, or either he permanently fasten the lock in such a way that he enter into a house, then it's a house breaking. As far as the punishment is concerned, in section 447 deal with the punishment for criminal trespass, which is 3 months and a fine of 500 rupees. As far as the punishment for house trespass is concerned, then the punishment is 1 year and 1,000 rupees. As far as the punishment for other offence is concerned, there is locking, house trespass and the house breaking, then punishment is 2 years. But if the offence is committed at night, that is the locking house trespass at locking house trespass at night and house breaking at night, then the punishment is 3 years since it's committed after the sunset. Now, nextly, I would like to move on to the offence against marriage. That is section 494 deal with the bigamy, where any person who is already married solemnizes another marriage, then it falls under the bigamy. However, I would like to take some examples. For example, if Mr. A solemnizes another marriage, even though he knows that he is married, but without informing his wife, or by concealing the first marriage, then the punishment is more grave. That is the imprisonment for 10 years. If you fall in the section 495, as far as the bigamy is concerned, the punishment is of 7 years. Then the next one is the adultery, where any person has any kind of sexual intercourse with another woman who is a married his husband is unaware about this fact, then this offense, it is not a rape but it is adultery. But I think by recent amendment even the adultery was repealed from the Indian Penal Code. Now I would like to move on to the next offense, that is a defamation, where any person either by orally or either in writing either transmit anything, any statement which actually disrepute that person, then in such case it fall under the defamation. The recent example I would like to take on this point is the Me Too movement. The many of the women say that this guy tried to molest me before 10 years, 20 years. If that guy actually committed the offense, then the thing is different. But if he not committed any offense, then he has a remedy to file a suit for the defamation, since that the statement of woman actually disreputed person, and that man also lost his image in the eyes of his family, his friends, as far as his employment is concerned also, and in somewhere even such kind of act is also amount to loss of their employment. So he can file the suit of defamation against a particular woman who alleged. Then the next one is section 510, that is where a drunken person would try to disturb the peace, then the police has right to detain the person for 24 hours. And the section 511, the last section of this Indian Penal Code, is where any offense which is punishable with a life imprisonment, but if any person attempts such offense which is punishable with life imprisonment, then it prescribes the punishment accordingly. Now I would like to take up Criminal Amendment Act 2013, where firstly it mainly focuses on the two sections, 354 and 376. 354 is assault. If any assault is committed in order to outraging the modesty of a woman, then the person is punished. Now section 354 A, B, C and D was added by the Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013. Section 354 A deals with sexual harassment, where if any man either he shows the pornographic content against her will, either he make any kind of demand or favor for sexual request, either he made any kind of the sexual color remark, then that particular man is punished, or a particular the offender is punished for the imprisonment for the 3 years. Then the next one is section 354B. 354B spoke about the disrobe, where any person try to disrobe the woman or try to force her to be naked, then in such case the imprisonment, the person is punished with imprisonment of 2 years. Then the next is voyeurism, when any woman is engaging in any kind of the private act, and if such act is recorded without her consent, without her permission, then the person is said to commit the offense of voyeurism. And the last one is 354D, stalking. I think this offense is committed by all the people. Either you follow any girl, any person, either on the social media or either virtually. This often, the stalking states that if any person follow up a woman, either not only on the not only virtually but also on the social media, and if she by her clear expression says that she is disinterested in you, and even though after you following her constantly, then it fall under the stalking, for which the punishment is prescribed under the Indian Penal Code. Now next, I would like to move on to the section 376. Even 376, the subsections were also added by inserted by the Criminal Law Amendment Act, where section 376A stated that where the rape victim goes into the vegetative state, then in such case the punishment is with rigorous imprisonment for the 10 years and certain fine is also prescribed. Then section 376B, where it stated that if any sexual intercourse is take place between the husband and wife during the period of separation, then such act is punishable with imprisonment up to 3 years, which may extend to 7 years, as according to the fact of the, which vary from case to case. Then section 376C, where any rape is committed by the authority or the person who is in some authority, like the doctor, the hospital management, the police, then in such case it is also punishable. On this point, I would like to cite one case, the Tukaram versus State of Maharashtra case, where the brother of that particular girl is called upon, and later on when the police detained his brother, and the girl, her sister, went to the police station, and the police officer who told to her parent to wait outside or go, and afterward the one constable raped her, and there another constable who tried to rape her, but since he was so under the influence of liquor, so he unable to commit a rape, and then the case goes to the High Court, where the High Court acquit and the Supreme Court convict. I think that's the judgment. Then the next one is section 376D, the gang rape, where the gang rape is committed on any woman, then also the punishment is very grave. That is, either it's the life imprisonment. Then the last one is section 376E, the repeat offender. Whoever commits the similar kind of offense repeatedly, then either such person is punished either with imprisonment for life, or he may get also a death penalty. It is also vary from case to case. Now, after this, I would like to also added, I think the recent amendment took place regarding the punishment for rape. The Criminal Law Amendment 2017-18 specifically mentioned three offences. Section 376AA, where the rape is committed on the woman who is under the age of 16 year. Section 376DA, which deal with when the gang rape is committed on the woman who is under the age of 16 years, for which the punishment is imprisonment for life or either death penalty. Here, imprisonment for life means the natural remainder life of that offender. And section 376DB, where the gang rape is committed on the woman who is under the age of 12 years. I think it's one of the most heinous offense, and such punishment must, and the offender must get the death penalty. Even the Indian Penal Code also prescribes the same, either imprisonment for life or death penalty. Now I would like to further I would like to move on to the section 326A, which was also added by the Criminal Law Amendment, not this one, the 2013. That is, when any person tried to cause a grievous hurt by throwing the acid, which is again the heinous crime, then in such case the person is punished either the imprisonment for 10 years, which may extend to life, and the fine which was levied by the court is definitely goes to the victim. And section 376 clause B deal with when any person tried to cause the grievous hurt or by attempt to throw the acid, then for which the imprisonment is 7 years. Then at last, I would like to go on. I would like to conclude that the future of a crime, where the future is not about the traditional crime, but it's about the cyber crime. For example, if any quarrel will take place between Mr. A and B, then Mr. A will not commit the traditional crime like murder, like grievous or to anything, but he will commit a cyber crime. Either identity theft will take place, or either Mr. A clean up account, hack the account of Mr. B and just transfer all the money to his account. So the future is not about this traditional crime, but in future it's about the cyber crime. And even the recent statement of the Mark Zuckerberg, who stated that even he is planning to merge all the largest platform of social media, that is the Facebook, WhatsApp and Instagram. So he planned to merge all these three. Now the biggest, the people will see the advantage that now it's like if we log in just one, then we will be access to all these three. But the biggest disadvantage of this thing is you are unable to protect your data. And again, there is further one advantage is you are able to access the information of the 35% of the total population of your world in just your fingertips. But what about your privacy? What about your security of the data? And even last year, even the Facebook was also charged with some as Facebook failed to protect the data of the users. And the debate is going on as well as America as well as in India is concerned. So I think the government should take a necessary step in order to over this kind of the crime, and especially due through this and when the specifically when this merging will done, then definitely on some line I feel that the main aim of the offender is to target the woman, because they can easily target the woman since they have all the data of the Facebook, of the WhatsApp and the Instagram. So I think the government should also take necessary step for the protection of the female account, the account of the woman. And at last, finally, since I am totally explaining the inner penal code, so I would like to utter the two line of the Bhagavad Gita at last, that always do the good karma and definitely it will come back to you. And don't be the victim of the Indian IPC, but be the boss of IPC. Thank you.
Thank you, Rudra. It was nice to hear a different perspective of the Indian Penal Code. And from Hammurabi, this is a token.
Thank you.
Thank you.